Okay, want to welcome everyone to tonight's September Library Community Service Commission meeting. And before we begin, I'd like to read the public notice because we're on using electronic means now. And the public notice is this meeting is being conducted utilizing teleconferencing and electronic means consistent with the State of California Executive Order N-29-20 dated March 17, 2020 regarding the COVID-19 pandemic. In accordance with the Executive Order N-29-20, the public may only view the meeting on television or or online and not in the council chamber. And based on the guidance from the California Department of Health and California Governor's Office in order to minimize the spread of COVID-19 virus, city meetings may be observed live at a website, which I'm not gonna read here. The city channel on YouTube and Comcast channel 29, I think Kristen mentioned that. If you wish to make comments, you need to submit your comments on 2 p.m. before our meeting on today and submit it to the administrative secretary. If you're watching the live stream, wish to make either a general public comment or to comment on specific agenda items or it is being heard, please submit your comment limited to 250 words or less to the administrative secretary. Every effort will be made to read your comment into the record, but some comments may not be read due to time limitations. Reading of public comments, the administrative secretary shall read all email comments, provided that the reading shall not exceed 2 minutes. The email comments submitted shall be part of the record. And if there's no questions, let's just move on to the Pledge of Allegiance. Could I have Commissioner Dallara lead us? And we'll stand, and I think we will have the flag. Ines will have a flag for us. There we go. And let's all stand and say a Pledge of Allegiance, and Commissioner Dallara lead.
You're on mute, Elmer.
Okay, I asked Commissioner Dallara to lead, but I guess he's on mute. So I'll go ahead and lead. Ready, set, go. A Pledge of Allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America
and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you, and please be seated. And let's move on to our next item, and that's the item of roll call. And S will do the roll call.
Good evening. Can I have a seat? Roll call for Commissioner Fong?
Here.
Commissioner Dursa?
Here.
Commissioner Martinez?
Here.
Commissioner Izquierdo?
Here.
Commissioner Dallara?
Here.
And Commissioner Oscar Romero? Yes. Thank you.
Okay, that take it. Okay, then let's go on to our next item for consideration is our minutes from July 8th. It's been a while since we've had a meeting. Commissioners, have you had a chance to read and review?
We need to do public comment.
Okay, I thought we'll do that, but I thought maybe it can't do no public. Okay, let's open it for public comments first.
Did receive two email comments, and she can read those now into the record.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I have two comments. The first one is as follows. The LSL Center for the Fine Arts, ACFA, has been part of the Salinas community for over 30 years. ACFA has provided a counter space for the estate community to be able to tell their true narrative through different arrays of art, such as art classes, theater workshops, and guitar lessons. The center and the community have been impacted in many ways that have allowed us to think about innovative ways to continue serving our community and students. We have adapted to the changes by providing virtual classes for our students, yet it has become difficult as many of the teachers have limited space in their homes to teach class online, as well as need access to material to teach courses. In order for us to continue to provide better services for our students and our community, we ask that you allow us to have an COVID-19
I didn't hear that part.
Sorry, guys, I didn't know I was muted. Should I start over?
Maybe the last paragraph.
Starting over?
Yes.
The Alisal Center for the Fine Arts, ACFA, has been part of the Salinas community for over 30 years. ACFA has provided a counter space for the Eastside community to be able to tell their true narrative through the different arrays of art, such as art classes, theater workshops, and guitar lessons. The center and the community have been impacted in many ways that have allowed us to think about innovative ways to continue serving our community and students. We have adapted to the changes by providing virtual classes for our students, yet it has become difficult as many of the teachers have limited space in their homes to teach a class online, as well as need access to material to teach courses. In order for us to continue to provide better services for our students in our community, we ask that you allow us to have an approved COVID-19 regulation schedule where a staff member and a teacher are able to host live and recorded sessions for our students in our community at the Breadbox. We don't ask for you to break any COVID-19 regulation, but like other organizations, letting us use this space to continue providing adequate space for our teacher to teach their classes online and our students, and allow our students opportunities to learn while online. I hope you will find it in your heart to follow, to allow some of our staff members and teachers to use the facility, as it will only benefit our community and students. We look forward to members and We look forward to and hoping for further discussion the situation. Best, LSL Center for the Fine Arts Board members, Liliana Cruz. That was one. The second one, submitted by Javier Tamayo, Executive Director from LSL for the Fine Arts. Greetings. On behalf of the LSL Center for the Fine Arts, parents and staff, we would like to request the use of the Breadbox facility for our staff to generate a series of YouTube videos and would benefit students and community members. We understand the closure of city facilities to the public due to the pandemic. The Breadbox has been home to ACFA programming for many years, which has allowed community members to have a connection to the facility. Our organization feels it is important to continue to serve our community during these difficult times while having an online presence from the Breadbox to demonstrate to our community we are still here. ACFA staff is committed to doing their part in reducing the COVID reducing the spread of COVID-19 by following these steps. One, take temperature prior to entering the Breadbox. Two, wearing a face covering at all times. Three, maintaining 6 feet distance. Four, limit number of staff. And five, keep hand sanitizer available. We hope to work collaboratively with city staff and build upon our relationships, resources, and services to better serve your community. Thank you. That is it. Two comments.
Albert, can't hear you.
There you go. Sorry about that. Okay. Is there any other public comment? Okay. Let's go on to our next item on our agenda is the recommendation to approve the minutes from July the 8th. Commissioners, have you had time to review it? And if so, could I have someone motion to pass?
Motion to pass.
Commissioner Dallara, motion to pass. Do I hear a second?
I'll second, Martinez.
Okay, Commissioner Martinez, second. All in favor say aye.
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 Thank you, commissioners. Okay, the next item is an item for consideration is the election of commissioner for chair and vice chair. And I'll turn this time over to our director, Kristen Lundquist. Kristen, could you take yourself on mute? There you go.
So, you know, this is the time annually when we elect a new chair and a vice chair for the commission. And so at this time, I think Albert, as the current vice chair, is going to entertain a motion for nominations for the chair.
Well, I'll nominate Albert as the chair.
Can I accept that motion? Because I was appointed by the mayor, and they may be a new appointment possibly.
You can accept it. As I mentioned to you, you had asked about this previously. At this point, there has been no changes made. So okay. You're still the mayor's representative.
Okay, then I would respectfully accept the nomination by Commissioner Dallara.
I would also like to nominate Dominic Dursa.
So we okay. have a nomination on the floor. Does anybody second Commissioner Dallara's nomination of Albert Fong?
I'll second it.
Okay, so we have to take each motion separately. So
okay.
So what we'll do is we'll, Inez, if you could call for the vote, and then depending on what happens with that, we'll entertain the second motion.
Okay, so we're going to be voting yes or no for Commissioner Fong for the chair. If you could tell me, Commissioner Fong, do you support?
Voting, is that what you're asking?
Yes.
Okay, yes.
Commissioner Dursa?
No.
Commissioner Martinez?
Nay.
Commissioner Dallara?
Yes.
Commissioner Izquierdo?
Yes.
Based on the voting, we have 3 yes and 2 no.
Okay, so that motion will carry and pass. So now we'll move on to the vice chair.
I'll nominate Dominic Dursa.
I second him.
Dominic, do you accept the nomination?
Sure.
Okay, I'm going to be calling a vote for the vice chair for Commissioner Dursa. Commissioner Fong, do you support?
Yes.
Commissioner Dursa?
Yes.
Commissioner Martinez?
Yes.
Commissioner Dallara?
Yes.
And Commissioner Izquierdo?
Yes.
Okay, that's a unanimous vote of 5 yes. Thank you.
Okay, we'll just move on to our next item. Am I off the mute? It's on the-
Congratulations, everybody.
Thank you, Commissioner. Okay, we're gonna move on to the Central Area Draft Specific Plan and Related Draft Environmental Impact Report.
Okay, hi. Miller from the Community Development Department. I'm the project manager for the Central Area Specific Plan. Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I have a PowerPoint which I'm going to attempt to share right now and see if I can figure that out. So bear with me here. Okay, are you seeing the
yes
PowerPoint? Okay, great. Okay, So first, I'm going to give you a little background on this project. The area shown in orange there on your screen is the area known as the Central Area Specific Plan. It has been identified for urban development along with the Greater North of Boronda FGA, Future Growth Area, which is shown there in the colors, in the 2002 general plan. The general plan requires a specific plan for future growth areas prior to any development to ensure that applicable general plan policies are included in the development, which include but are not limited to new urbanism design principles. The area was annexed in 2008 into city limits with this vision in mind, and had been divided up into these three areas per council direction around that time. The green area was carved out of the west area portion to facilitate commercial development there. That's the new Lowe's. And the area we're dealing with is about 760 gross acres. And what you're seeing there on this next slide is the sort of general land use layout. The maximum considered in the EIR is 3,911 dwelling units provided across low, medium, and high densities. 4,809,700 square feet of mixed-use commercial floor area, and 17 parks, 3 school sites, a 2-acre library site, and a fire station. And the library site is 2 net acres, and I will get into the parks breakdown, your area of interest here, in the next slide right here. So you could see in this land use plan, the areas shown in the dark green are the parks. They are small and neighborhood parks. And then there's the 2 creek corridors identified in light green for open space offering passive recreation opportunities. So this slide shows the breakdown of all the different small and neighborhood parks. The community park, for any of you who were on the board last year, is provided in the west area. So the community park requirement for the North of Boronda future growth area is met in the west area. So the parks proposed here in the central fall between small and neighborhood. Small parks are a minimum of 0.5 acre, and neighborhood parks are a minimum of 2 acres. You will notice CA5, the neighborhood park, is 11.68 acres. So that is a particularly generous neighborhood park. And the park requirement is based on the Quimby Act, which is 3 acres of parkland per 1,000 people. So with that, they're proposing about 1 acre over what the minimum would be. Parks would be developed as housing's developed to ensure that ratio is met. So this is the same plan you saw before, just with the emphasis on the parks and open space. So the wedge that you see sort of at the southeast side is that large 11.6 acre park. And those open space paths provide pedestrian and bicycle access along a 300 foot open space area across both of those. That's the Gablan and Tividad Creek. Another principle of new urbanism development is walkability, bikeability, connectivity. So this is a graphic pulled from the specific plan that demonstrates a 5- and 10-minute walk within basically the entire plan area, showing that the parks are complying with that, that standard of having it accessible to most residents within a reasonable walking distance. And this is just a conceptual graphic of how the park may be developed. The parks will be developed, you know, along with the maps and based on probably some level of input from you and the public. But the bottom line is the parks will be required to comply with the current city park and sport facility standards. And that, you know, may include overlap for multiple types of of play fields and recreational activities accommodated in a single park, for example. And so this feature, the northerly and southerly greenway streets, these are a really interesting feature of the FGA, I think. They are these enhanced multimodal paths that will ultimately connect all three of those plan areas that you saw in the first graphic in red, orange, yellow. So the southerly greenway street is going to be particularly enhanced. These are the street sections here for you to see. It will have a 12-foot sidewalk with an 8-foot landscape planter on either side. So it's gonna, you know, at build out be nice and shaded. It's a generous size sidewalk to hopefully encourage walking and biking, accommodate all those different multimodal vehicles, and hopefully reduce the reliance on the individual automobile, which is a principle of new urbanism. And the northerly greenway is a similar amenity with a slightly narrower pathway with an 8-foot sidewalk and the 8-foot landscaping on either side. So those greenways, if you can read this little, can you see my cursor when I share the screen?
Yes.
Yes.
Cool, is the southerly greenway, and see, it will ultimately connect to the future East Area Specific Plan, which has yet to be submitted, but is the third there, and then connects over here to the West Area Specific Plan, which you took a look at last spring. And the northerly greenway is up this way and will ultimately connect the three plan areas and the open space corridors. So hopefully it'll offer some nice outdoor multimodal opportunities for our residents. Of course, as part of the consideration of the plan, we have to include the public transit aspect of it. This is a concept that MST had reviewed. It's part of the specific plan graphics, just kind of demonstrating that the areas envisioned to offer public transit opportunities along those walkable open space corridors. And that concludes my presentation. I'm available for questions from the commission.
Commissioners, do you have any questions for Jill, our planner?
Jill, 20, 30 years out?
The full is anticipated to be between 20 and 30 years. We provide that estimate in the documents because, as is the case with the West area as well, the area is comprised of multiple property ownerships and interests. A lot of how quickly it'll be developed will be market driven. And so 20 to 30 years for full build out, but as maps come in to develop these homes, they'll be needing to identify how they're meeting their Quimby Act requirement with the parks. So the parks will get developed along with the houses. And the library site will be funded through the public facilities fee. And so development will occur there as funding allows.
Commissioner Dursa, do you have any questions for our planner, Mrs. Miller?
In terms of some of the parks that are near schools, have there already been preliminary discussions in terms of how there might be joint use or joint maintenance of these parks?
Certainly, we encourage that. You know, it has to end up being an agreement between the school and the city, but definitely we encourage that. And you're exactly right. Proximity to the schools is part of the planning process when establishing the park plan.
So is there anything within the timeline of when those conversations may occur, or is it just something that's going to be encouraged to happen?
I don't think we have a specific timeline identified for when those discussions occur. But certainly as part of my report to this meeting, you know, to the Planning Commission and ultimately the City Council, I can bring up that point and make sure that it's pointed out as an area of interest for this commission.
I only say that because I know I coached baseball at the Montebello field next to the school, and it's nice grass, but a lot of divots in there. So infield was murder on that field. So maintenance is definitely key. Another question, in terms of the number of acres that are going to be added of parkland, excuse me, is there an estimate to how many employees are going to be needed to maintain those parks?
You know, the fiscal impact analysis identified a ballpark. I don't recall the number of employees off the top of my head. We did the fiscal analysis for these projects about 2 years ago. So I'm not sure, Kristen, if you would have any idea of that off the top of your head either.
I don't either, but we can certainly get you that information.
Yeah, we sure can.
That'd be good to know. I mean, we already have a few issues just maintaining the parks we have. So just making sure.
And if you'll give me 1 second to look up in the specific plan, the maintenance.
Definitely.
I have the document right here. If you just give me a quick second to double check. I believe that the maintenance of the parks is identified in our financing section. So small parks would be maintained under a landscape and lighting maintenance district. So the small parks would be funded in that way for maintenance. So I guess the neighborhood parks then would be subject to the city maintenance. However, there's also a development agreement that's being negotiated for the project. So things like maintenance responsibilities and funding are part of that discussion. And so as city staff goes through that document, you know, funding may be further vetted in that way for maintenance.
Awesome. Thank you.
Commissioner Martinez, do you have any questions for Ms. Miller?
Just a comment on the numbers about the acreage and the financing for employees. I know that they're old numbers, and I know Josh was supposed to get us new numbers as per Monterey County and how it averages out with the nation and the rest of the county and the rest of the state. So if you did your analysis off 2 years ago, well, then those numbers are no longer correct.
Well, the fiscal report was initiated 2 years ago when the assumptions, are you suggesting the number of employees has changed? I'm not sure I understand the comment.
The number of employees should change because from what I remember is Josh said that the countywide and statewide that the average it has gone up, and that we are below average in our in how many acres we're giving to each employee. We're giving them more acres per employee, so that needs to be adjusted so that those acres get the proper amount of employees, basically, because as parks and community LCS as a whole needs to adjust that and then give you the numbers so that once it's adjusted how many employees per acre, well, then you can make proper adjustments to your paperwork.
Interesting. Yeah, the fiscal impact analysis is completed at this point. However, it did show a surplus. It's going to it's estimated to be a moneymaker for the city. I don't have those numbers in front of me, but I think it's somewhere between 1.5 million and 2 in the first 5 years. So, you know, we'll have maybe a little extra to play with to make sure those parks are cared for.
Awesome.
Okay. Okay, Commissioner Izaguirre, do you have any questions or comment?
No, actually, I would like to get a copy also of the numbers, please. Would appreciate that.
The fiscal impact analysis?
Yes, please.
Okay, we'll provide it.
And yeah, so to me, it's pretty much the same concern that I think everybody else has, is that it's great that we're having all these new parks that are going to most likely be built in with the new housing that's going to hopefully under 20 years, but gets built. But the biggest thing is also is just what, you know, making sure that there's enough of a budget to cover all the workers that are needed to maintain those parks, and that doesn't impact the existing parks right now that are definitely understaffed. Right now, I think the biggest issue right now with parks is that, well, right now they're not being used much, but once everything is back to normal, we're expecting, you know, everybody to be wanting to go onto the parks, and they're going to need a lot of maintenance. And if we have, you know, new parks coming in, but not enough staffing, that's definitely going to be an issue impacting our existing parks and even new parks coming up, you know, in the community. So I definitely am I'm hoping that the budget does get re-reviewed, you know, understand it happened 2 years ago, but a lot has changed, and definitely want to make sure that we have the best analysis available once this gets implemented. Thank you for all the information.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, commissioners.
Can I add something? I just wanted to ask an additional question, ask a question this time. So with these parks, there will be play structures and things that are to be physically touched by human beings, I suspect.
Right.
Since nobody really knows about the current pandemic situation, what guidelines are you going to follow as far as to even build those things if we've taped up and gated up all the other things that people interact with? Has there been a conversation about that?
I think we're having it right now. It's a good question to raise. You know, I think that the new parks would be subject to the regulations that the existing parks are subject to. With any luck, you know, I don't expect any sort of vertical construction to happen here for maybe another 2 to 3 years. Should the city council elect to entitle the project, we have to go through subdivision improvements, place infrastructure before you start seeing rooftops that trigger the parks. So with any luck by then, the pandemic will be under control. But, you know, I guess the short answer is the parks would be subject to whatever regulations are applying to parks citywide. And just quickly, while we're on the topic of the maintenance question, I was just jumping through the maintenance responsibilities in the specific plan. Chapter 8 talks about it. And that development agreement that I mentioned may identify some of these funding mechanisms. But the city has suggested a community facilities district or a similar type financing entity to cover the park maintenance to try to offset those costs and achieve a higher level of park maintenance. It's been sort of a public comment that we've received regularly to have better maintenance of our parks. So that's another option that may occur that will be determined through the development agreement.
All right. Well, thank you for your answer.
Mm-hmm.
You heard it here first, everybody. The pandemic will be gone by the time we break ground.
I hope so.
Okay. We received the presentation from our planner, Miss Jill Miller. I think this, if it's appropriate, this is the time that we have to vote to make the recommendation of this plan, approve the park plan as presented in the specific plan. So could I have Inez help us with the voting, since we're on computers? I don't really see people the way we usually do.
So, Commissioner Fall, if we could get a motion.
Okay.
To approve, make a recommendation to the city council that they approve this.
Absolutely. Okay, do I hear a motion from one of our commissioners and a second, and then we'll vote?
I'd like to motion that we recommend to City Council to approve this.
Thank you, Commissioner Martinez made the motion. Do I hear a second?
I'll second it. This is Elmer.
Okay, Commissioner Delara, second the motion. And do I hear a Yes, from all the commissioners?
Yes.
Any nays? No, abstention?
If I could, yeah. I think it would be good for Inez to call the roll because, you know, we're all on individual systems and it would be better for the record keeping.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, commissioners, I'm going to be calling the vote. Can you please tell me if you support that motion? Commissioner Fong?
Yes.
Commissioner Dursa?
Yes.
Commissioner Martinez?
Yes.
Commissioner Dolera?
Yes.
And Commissioner Izquierdo?
Yes.
Okay, the voting is done. All is unanimous, and this motion will carry. Thank you.
Thank you, Inez. And now could we go to our next item presentation, and it's the library response to digital divide. Could I have Kristen lead us on that? And you're on mute right now. Okay, there you go.
I'm going to introduce Mila Rianto, our deputy librarian, who's going to give you this presentation.
Hi. Good evening, commissioners. I'm going to set up my presentations real quick here. All right. Can everybody see my presentation?
Yes.
Now we can.
Yes.
All right, perfect. So we would like to present some information on libraries' efforts to bridge the digital divide here in Salinas. The first thing that we want to acknowledge that is we do realize that there are digital divide here in Salinas. And one thing that we want to do is we want to define the library's function and roles in this effort, because as we all know that this is an issue that requires work from everyone in our community. So we are fully aware of the existing digital divide in our city, and the COVID-19 situation definitely amplified the significance of it because for almost 6 months now, more services and activities requires dependency on internet service for people to connect with each other. And as remote learning becomes more of a norm during this period, we also noticed that there are logistical difficulties for our families and students to provide opportunity to do remote learning. But for our library itself, the digital divide does go beyond the ability to access internet. So it is for us, the service goes beyond those that have internet access versus those that doesn't have internet access. That's definitely a big part of it. But for us, the digital divide also represents the gap between those with the knowledge to utilize the technology and those without that knowledge. So one thing that I do want to make sure everyone knows that during the COVID-19 closure, that the library continues to provide a few things. One of the things that we do provide during the closure is free public Wi-Fi at all of our locations. So we have three locations here in the city. And the public Wi-Fi is available 7 days a week for 12 hours of the day, between the hours of 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. And the Wi-Fi is accessible from the library's parking lot. And recently, we actually increases the range of our Wi-Fi range. So at the beginning of the closure, the Wi-Fi can only be accessed if you park really close to the library. But because we have increased it, it actually covers most of the parking lot area at any of our three library locations. The other thing that we keep doing is our literacy center team has pivoted to providing virtual computer classes. So in case you're not familiar, our literacy center provide basic computer classes, which introduce people on how to use a computer, how to connect to computer, and also internet safety. And during this period, where students cannot come to the building to use the equipment to use it, to learn on their computer classes, we have actually provided lending our devices to participants of the computer classes, so they would be able to go along with the classes. And of course, in the past few years, we have been managing and adding our online resources, which during this closure has become very essential in providing our services. But we do realize that with the digital divide, the one thing that we have yet to provide and what is needed by the community is providing those internet access to our community. So the first thing that we have been trying to figure out and ever since the beginning of this pandemic is how we can provide hotspots for our families. So since May, I think we have been planning for additional service to provide hotspots and lending computer for the general public and also for targeted parents and students by working with the four elementary schools that we currently work with to provide homework centers. So to provide this hotspot, obviously we would need funding. So one of the things that we have also been working since May is trying to look for and applying for different grants to fund this project. So we applied for two grants. One is from the Institute of Museum and Library through the CARES Act and also through the Packard Foundation from the Community Foundation of Monterey County. So these two grants hopefully would be able to fund the hotspots and device lending project that we've been planning since May. Recently, at the end of July, we received notice that Packard has granted us our request for grant. And I believe last week or a couple of weeks ago, the grant was accepted by the council. We are still waiting decision for the CARES Act grant, which hopefully going to come this month or next month. Another thing that we've been working on is mapping the availability of free Wi-Fi around the city. So this is a project by our city GIS team. So they created this map that basically listed all the public free Wi-Fi access available in the city, which also includes our libraries and our recreation centers as well. And
if I can ask if we can go back, Mila, one slide. Yes. So I know Commissioner Durr said this was something that you encouraged us to kind of undertake two meetings ago, and you know, this is an example, I think, of how there are so many in the community that are working together, that are working on a particular issue, and sometimes it's about getting people coordinated. And so this information actually was initially developed by Dr. Carissa Purnell with the Alisal Union School District. There's been various iterations of maps, I think, that you may have already seen on social media. And so when I saw she had created this list, I contacted her, said, hey, we should really kind of try to work together to see how we could grow this map. So I've made contact with the Chamber of Commerce and hoping to work with them and SUBA as well to expand this list. We know that this is just the tip of the iceberg, right? So having the access to the free Wi-Fi is very important. But then that only fills that one piece of the pie, right? And so I think the picture that circulated all over social media of those two young girls sitting out on the curb in front of Taco Bell, I think that really hit home for many of us in the community. And so this is just one piece, right, is making sure that there's access and devices available. But ultimately, it's, you know, also we need to look at how, as a community, we can help support our young children during the middle of this pandemic while they're, you know, facing distance learning and providing adequate spaces to help support our families.
So if any of the commissioners have any questions, I would be happy to answer them.
Should I go first or?
Go ahead, Commissioner Dursa.
Got a few, just a few though.
All right.
First off, thank you, Mila, for the presentation. First off, yeah, great work on the Wi-Fi access map. I know a lot of people collaborated on it. The first question I have regarding it is how do we find it? I kind of wandered around social media. I wandered around the websites. And while I personally know the link for one of the versions of the map, I couldn't even find this map anymore. So where is it?
So we currently haven't added it to our social media or our website for this version of the map because, our GIS team said that they will have the link ready by the end of this week. So I'm hoping that we would be able to add those in before the end of this week.
Couple other questions. In terms of the grants that were discussed, I did read about it online, the $50,000 grant received from the Packard Foundation. However, one of the points made, and I quote, providing Chromebooks and laptops at our libraries that can be borrowed by library card holders once we reopen. My question is, if the libraries aren't open, what's the point of applying for a grant to provide Chromebooks during a crisis partly caused by the libraries being closed and people not being able to access the computers there?
Of course. I think one of the things that we have to clarify on that is as we progress on our reopening plan, I think that that's the part that we can define as reopening. Because as you also aware from our curbside service, we started with a very minimal service, but we have been able to expand it a little bit more as you know, as we see the situation and as we see the need. So one of the things that our reopening team has been discussing is to how can we provide, because we know this is a need in our community, how can we provide printing service and a computer service safely for our community? So when we said, as we, we're gonna try to provide those hotspots and device lending when we're reopened, I think that's what we meant. It's not, it doesn't mean that we have to open our doors fully like we did before the closure, but is as we progress with our reopening and we can do it safely, that's what we will do.
And I'll just point that out. That's from September 2nd. So, I mean, it definitely helps to get clarification.
Absolutely.
But I mean, it reads pretty plainly once we reopen. So, I mean, you could see why the confusion. But thank you for leading me to my next point in terms of special services being expanded without perhaps reopening. What kind of conversations have been going on perhaps with other library systems in order to adapt? And a couple instances I do want to bring up. The Castorville Library has a student study area with Wi-Fi that they'll open up to students from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Another thing you brought up that I also happened to read about as well is down in LA County, they're offering printing services, Chromebook services, hotspots, but I do want to emphasize that printing service where residents who have a library card can get 10 pages a day with everybody having to do their homework from home. If people can't go to the library to print out an application, there's a big gap in there, you know? And so is there any conversations to how services can be adapted? Because I haven't heard of anything saying COVID's going to go away anytime soon. So, I mean, we really do have to think long-term, how are we going to kind of fill in the gaps? Safely, I understand, but nevertheless, those gaps are clearly there.
Absolutely. And that is part of the conversation that we have internally, but also we are looking out towards what other library has been doing and also what can we do safely here in Salinas. And all the points that you've made is definitely something that other libraries has been doing. And for LA County, especially because I actually also got their newsletter, so I kind of know what they've been providing. And one of the things that they have is probably they have a more established logistic to provide all those devices and the wireless printing service than what we do. But we are going that way, and the reason that we are going to provide those services is because we do realize that there is a need in our community. We do hear it from some of the questions that we receive through our social media or through our website. And we definitely hear, and we will try to address those concerns and meet the needs of our community.
So, I mean, it's great that there's internal conversations, and while I'm not necessarily expecting calls to be made to LA, or at least conversations happening with other local libraries like Castroville to maybe see what they're doing to see if it is adaptable to Salinas.
Yes, because one of the things, so our regional library here in Monterey County, we actually do talk to each other. We have a consortium. So we do exchange ideas and we hear what others are doing. Conversation with other libraries are definitely, especially here locally, are definitely being made.
Thank you. Again, considering the Wi-Fi being open at library sites, I brought this up a few months ago as well. There's no advertising related to this. I mentioned again, Monterey County Free Libraries has it quite clearly when you go to their landing page that Wi-Fi is open, it's accessible, what times. I still see the website for Salinas Libraries hasn't been updated. It's great that Wi-Fi is available, but if nobody knows, again, that's an issue. Is there going to be any work done to either adjust the website or make this information more widely known?
We will definitely try to make it more widely known than what it is right now, because the information I know is available on the website, but it is, like you said, it's not as prominent as it is on our, let's say, on our homepage.
If you could send me the link to that, that'd be great.
Sure. On our page where the Wi-Fi information is?
Yeah.
I mean, it's actually on each of the location. We do say that we have Wi-Fi available at the library, but like I mentioned, it is not as prominent on our homepage.
Perfect.
But yeah, no, definitely. I will send you the information.
Thank you for clarifying that. One last thing. Is there other CARES funding that the city's received that perhaps can be adapted? And it's probably more for Kristen, perhaps, for adapting library services that the city might have received. I know the housing department, I think, got CARES funding for doing outreach.
Not specifically. The city has received, I think, close to $2 million in CARES funding that has been earmarked for a variety of different costs that the city has incurred since the pandemic started. So at this point, there isn't any of that that's been earmarked for the libraries to expand service or anything like that.
Thank you, Kristen.
Okay. Could I, Commissioner Martinez, do you have any questions for Mila? Any comment?
Yes. What was I gonna ask? darn it, I had a question that was important too.
I could come back to you.
Come back to me.
Okay. Commissioner Izaguirre, do you have any comments or questions for Mila?
Well, yes and no. It's been great to see that there is some services that have been provided to our community. Definitely in this time right now, it's very important. I guess I did want to ask, how's everything going as far as the checkout of the equipment that you are able to lend out to our community? Is that on a rotational basis for a certain period of time, for a couple hours only? How is that working right
well,
now?
Well, currently the only equipment that's being lend out to the community is only through our literacy center's computer classes. So it's class related equipment.
Okay. And have you been having a high demand for that? Or is that something that's been a little stagnant or just steady?
We do. I know the literacy center do limit the number of students that can be in the class to make the class effective. So I think so far they have been able to provide devices to all the students that sign up for the class.
Oh, that's good to hear. And I'm guessing, is there a plan? I know there was a discussion right now with with Dominic regarding the whole emphasis on trying to provide additional services, like, you know, if people need it, if somebody in the community needs like a document printed or so forth. Is there a plan for that, or is that just not till the government says, okay, everything's open?
No, that there's definitely a plan for it. And I think that is part of our reopening plan since the beginning, that we are going to open the service phases by phases, in addition to following and figuring out what is the safety protocols in providing those services. It also to accommodate the limited number of staff that we have working on site. So we're trying to kind of manage all of that, and in addition to making sure that everyone from the different, you know, areas in our community would have service, would have library services, and we are doing it phases by phases. But the printing and hopefully once we figure out how to access, use the computers is definitely in, is one of our top plan of what to do on our list.
Yeah, and I mean, I know everybody talks about the essential workers, you know, only being like in the medical field or in other areas, but I think the libraries are essential right now, especially with everybody in the city being, you know, studying from home as far as our community members go, you know, anything from elementary to our college students are, you know, working online. And having those resources available, I think, are essential for in order to continue moving forward. You know, we don't know how long this could probably be over next month, but it could probably push over to next year. So is there an ETA as far as how soon the libraries may be at least providing some restricted services? I know that it wouldn't be open, you know, overnight as far as to the, all the public at once, but and as far as, is there any phases that are already taken into consideration and how long that would take to implement them?
Well, currently we're still figuring out the plan to do that. So I am hoping that we might be able to provide some updates for you by the time next LCS Commission meeting rolls around.
Okay.
But just to elaborate, Commissioner Izaguirre, we are currently providing curbside service, and so residents can either online or by phone request materials, and then we have a safe protocol to pass those materials off. We also have opened all of our book returns, and so people who have had materials that were checked out before this pandemic hit, we are accepting those returns as well. So we do have services in place. It's just continuing that planning to ensure that we provide a safe environment for our employees, as well as residents and community who come to use our services.
Okay, well, yeah, I was aware about the pickup being available now, which is great. I think, I guess, you know, my actually more of a concern is right now, you know, all of our kids or all the children in our community are out there, you know, needing these services. And I think hopefully we're able to expand on a little bit more. I understand that there's a big safety concern. And, you know, at this point, you know, it impacts everybody differently. So I know some are more severe than others. So I definitely understand the caution that we're taking to, you know, open up completely and not just by steps. So by steps, I definitely agree. I just think that there should be a little bit of, at least of an ETA of when to expect to have a little bit of more resources available to our public. So hopefully there'll be an update in our next meeting, and hopefully there is close to fruition where we'll be able to see more services for our community. Thank you for all that information. I really appreciate it.
Okay. Commissioner Dallara, do you have any comments or questions for Mila?
None.
Okay. If not, we want to thank our Deputy Librarian Mila Rianto for the presentation, and it's good hearing the updates. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Now
My question. I'll email you, Mila.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. But we're down to the commissioner's report, so maybe I can begin with Commissioner Martinez. Do you have any comments or commissioner's report?
No, nothing to report. All's good and orange in the sky right now.
Awesome. How about you, Commissioner Dallara?
I'll be talking to Kristen later offline regarding Central Park, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Sam Sherwood. Thank you.
Okay. And Commissioner Izquierdo?
Actually, no, I had some links that I want to share, but I don't have them on hand, so I'll definitely be sharing those in the next meeting.
Okay.
Going on, everybody's forgetting stuff around here.
Yeah.
Thank you. Anything from you, Commissioner Dursa, report?
A couple.
Okay.
First off, thank you to Kristen for bringing us that report and Mila on the status of the digital divide and how the library was addressing it. I requested last month, and it was good to see. I'd like to make a couple requests for next month if we can get some further information on a few items related to the public comment that occurred today. Could we perhaps hear more about any conversations or progress being made between what the city is doing to reach out to organizations who previously were using city facilities that have been affected by COVID, specifically the ones in the district to represent include the soccer fields, the Constitution Complex, of course, the Bread Box, First Tee, Natividad Creek Park. What I'm really looking for is, you know, these organizations, these nonprofits, they do have to apply for grants, I imagine, yearly and have to show what it is they've been doing. Certainly beginning of COVID, a lot of people just kind of had to wait and see. But again, as things are moving forward, we have to figure out ways to adapt. And we do have to find ways to support our local nonprofits. So I'd like to see what's going on in those regards so that we don't lose nonprofits to lack of activity because of COVID. So if that's one thing I could request to hear more about next month.
Okay.
The second thing I'd like to hear a bit more about is on social media outreach. I kind of talked about it a few months ago, but again, I think it's important we do a deeper dive on it. And the reason why is this is, again, before so many of these services were exposed to people because they were there, they attended things, whether they were at, you know, a downtown youth center by the library, whether they went to libraries, any number of pop-ups going on throughout the city, they got to see the great work that the Library Community Services Division was doing. Now that everything has moved online, of course, it can be a bit more difficult to see things. And so what I want to see is, you know, what are the plans for the different channels that have been used to put things out on social media, like the why, what's the target audience, you know, who are the content creators? And I ask because I do have some questions. You know, when we talk about the Salinas Parks and Rec Instagram, there's 146 posts. I only see three that even show the parks. You know, and so what kind of decision goes into that? And I think it is important because, you know, over this next year, again, budget talks are going to come back, and it's important people see the good things that are they're being done, and things like parks are important. And so I would like to talk more about what is being done social media wise, just to make sure that people are staying connected to the good deeds that LCS as a department is doing. And yeah, thank you to those who came from AGFA for speaking up and just asking to have that broader conversation. I think it is important we hear from groups like that because, you know, one of the hard things is, yeah, a lot of people are looking for ways to stay engaged during this shelter in place. And we certainly have wonderful groups, whether it's AGFA, Artists Inc., Bakhtun 12, you know, any number of sports organizations like, you know, Gil Basketball Academy. There's any number of groups that can be collaborated with to really highlight the good deeds going on in the city, so to speak. So that's it.
Thank you, Commissioner Dursa. And I just have a couple of minor things. I want to thank Inez for getting the Library Community Service pandemic mask out to us. And if you haven't gotten it, you'll probably get it shortly. And I just had one question, whether we could purchase some maybe for a fundraiser to our libraries. And just curious whether there will be extras that we could buy to give out as gifts or something, but you don't need to answer now unless you can. The other thing is maybe our director, Kristen Lundquist, will include in her report is that you mentioned that you may update us on what's going on with Sherwood Park, the tennis courts and swimming pool. I don't even know if that's open, but maybe not. So I'll just leave it to you and your report. And you're on mute, so if you give us your report, I won't be able to hear you.
Can I make a comment before she starts?
Yes, of course.
Okay, so it came back to me. I remembered what I needed to say to Mila, and this goes overall for library and community services is if you email me anything that needs to be spread out to the community. I'm on a local radio station, KHDC 90.9 FM, which is known as Radio Bilingue, with a humongous listenership, predominantly, obviously, Hispanic. This is the lifeline to them because we're the ones getting them information on the COVID daily, like every hour. And the census, we're the ones that are pushing really, really hard for compliance. For these things too, if Library and Community Services needs to get things read on the air, to just email it to me. And I can have that put in a community calendar that the disc jockeys, which there are umpteen of them, will read every half hour. That's my comment.
Thank you, Commissioner Martinez. Thank you again, Mila, for your presentation. And now we'll go to our director's report. Kristen?
Yeah, thank you. And so just to touch a little bit on tennis, I hope to have a little more detail. Many of you may be aware that our tennis pro, his agreement expired at the end of August. We did extend it for a 2-week period so that he could really, you know, move his equipment out and his belongings out. That agreement, that extension is good through this Sunday. But while we've been in communication, you know, since the beginning of COVID-19, we've been working with the tennis pro on how we could open. Once we realized that he was not interested in extending or continuing as the tennis pro for us. I have been in discussions with another organization around how we can collaborate in the short term. You may recall when we brought the agreement with the tennis pro to you 2 years ago, we also indicated that at the conclusion of this this agreement, we would be then going out for an RFP, which is a request for proposal. Given the current circumstances, given the current pandemic, this really is not a time to do. We don't have the statistics to put out and do an RFP. And so I'm trying to come up with a creative solution. I have heard from Commissioner Fong and Commissioner Dallara the importance of trying to get the tennis center open. So we are working through a process. I can't go into much detail because around the sensitivity of it, but I just want to assure you that we are working on a plan with the goal to get the tennis center open as soon as we can. So as soon as I can give more information, I will do that. Commissioner Dallara, feel free to give me a call. We can talk offline, but I can't go into too much details, but we can talk through kind of where we're trying to get to. So I hope to have by next meeting, an actual formal presentation around a plan, and I will keep you all posted. I also wanted to let you know the dog park is now open to the public. We have proper signage up with the various guidance and rules around dog parks, just like all of our other parks, where we're, you know, they're open for exercise, they're open for family and social circles, activities. I can't stress, to you anymore that I'm sure you're already hearing, Monterey County is in the most at-risk tier of the state's return. We are doing everything we can to protect the community. Health and safety is so important to us. And so that also includes our employees. And so the city at this point, due to the current status and the data around our statistics with COVID-19 positive cases, has still made a determination that the facilities are closed to the public and to non-employees. I think if you read the daily monitoring list that Monterey County puts out, just in terms of some numbers for you to think about. So they're looking at a couple of big numbers, and one of them has to do with the 14-day cumulative COVID-19 incidents per 100,000 people, right? We are at 295.7. In order for the state to consider moving us out of this tier four, which is the purple tier, we have to be below 32. That's a very significant change that we need to see. Also, in terms of the 7-day average, a daily percent change in total numbers it's the overall test positivity rate for the past 7 days. We're at 15.7. Last I saw, that was almost double the state. And in order to be considered for moving past out of this tier, we have to be below 8%. So I want to encourage everybody to please wear your masks when you're out in public. Make sure you wash your hands and really do your best to follow the shelter in place. We still are under a shelter in place order from the state. And I know it's very challenging, I think, for all of us to stay home and only be out for essential things. But I gotta stress that it's still really important. And I hope you continue to share that same message with your family and those you come into contact with as well. And that concludes my report.
Thank you, Kristen.
Kristen, just a question then. So on the determination of things being done, the food drives are being done at some of the locations, correct?
We have food bank distribution, correct.
And some of the staff are working on that, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So again, while I'm not trying to be flippant, you know, the numbers certainly are serious. As great as the need is, what I'm looking for is creativity in trying to address some of those needs. Because certainly the challenge that we're in is needs have to be met regardless. Because I'll be blunt in saying I'm tired of Salinas being nationally focused for our failures. And it's not any one person, group, or whomever that's responsible for it. It's everybody gets to take in that blame. But nevertheless, people need to get their education. People need to do things like apply for jobs. And so when we see other places who are also within the same situation as us, like Castroville, it does throw me off a little bit because their numbers aren't that great either. You know, I mean, I look at the numbers quite often as well. So, you know, that's the one thing that kind of comes to mind is, you know, how can we take advantage of perhaps the creative methods that others are using to ensure that those some services can be maintained. Obviously, we can't pack the libraries again, but, you know, non-contact printing where stuff is left for people to pick up, you know, those types of things, yeah, are perhaps possible.
And we completely agree with you, and we're working through that with our reopening team around a phase of when we can get to that service. So we fully agree with you, Commissioner Dursa.
One last question. Is there going to be a push by the LCS department on the census in the last 3 weeks? I just ask, you know, I know some organizations have been doing phone banking. You know, they've been able to use like work time to do things like phone banking. Is there going to be a bigger social media push, you know, because those census dollars are so important to things like libraries and parks?
Sorry. So we're working with the city's census team, and Mila is actually part of that team. And so we'll be providing support. It's actually led out of the Community Development Department, but we certainly are in communication with them about how we can push and emphasize the importance of the census. We agree that, you know, there are lots of dollars at risk if we don't improve our rate of response.
Thank you.
If I may, I'd like to piggyback on some of the things that Dominic Dursa, Commissioner Dursa was saying, and for Kristen, for you to have that same enthusiasm for opening the tennis courts, to open up places like the Bread Box and the Hebron Center, and give us a detailed report exactly like the one you're doing for the tennis court. Can you do that for the other buildings that organizations use? Can we have that report from you too?
I mean, I can certainly put together a report for you. I will tell you right now, the position is those recreation centers, and primarily it's because it's an indoor facility, are not
there parking lots. You know, there's parking lots in use around. I mean,
there are, but we don't have anybody other than staff inside our facilities. And so out of the protection for staff, out of the protection for the community, the city, and this is not just something the Library and Community Services Department is doing. This is a policy citywide across the city. City Hall is not open.
Conversation for the city then?
I'm sorry, what?
So this is a conversation we need to have with the city about opening up a little bit more, opening the conversation about more creative ways of addressing our city's broader needs. It's kind of like this right now. And
it is, because we're in the middle of a pandemic. And so there's concern of safety for community and for our staff. And so that's really been the city's position. No other city facility is open to the public. I have been in communication with organizations and expressed the position of the city, and we'll continue those conversations. If we can see that our numbers drop, you know, in addition to the numbers I referred to, you know, Salinas is like 55% of all of Monterey County cases. So when we start to see those numbers drop and we're allowed to have other openings and other things occur, we are absolutely on board. That's something we want to see. You know, we want in-person activities just as much as all of you do. So we're going to continue to look at that data and make data-informed decisions.
So what is the pathway to have open conversations with organizations and so that the city, LCS, and organizations and the public can come together in a Zoom type format and a town hall type of thing where people can express their needs and other city officials and leaders can hear this and we can open the dialogue, because right now the dialogue seems very, very, very strict and it can't stay that way because it's gonna have a very, very detrimental effect. It's already showing. So we need to open the parking lots, have satellite spaces. We have open space, and there is a way to use the open space and also follow guidelines. The rest of the nation and the county and the state are doing this. So we need a conversation.
We would encourage residents to use open space. We would encourage organizations to use outdoor space. Where we run into challenges is that indoor environment currently.
Yeah, but also access to some facility, because I know like there's a kitchen at the Cesar Chavez branch, you know, that could be used still to be cooking food for people in fire situations. We're already giving food at the bread box. The multi-purpose room has a couple of uses that it could still be used for. It just, the dialogue needs to be opened and it can't just be sealed shut right now. That's what I'm saying.
Thank you, so noted.
Okay, thank you, Director Kristen, for her report. And also thank all our commissioner for your input, your valuable input. And we are, I think Kristen and the city staff are sensitive to what we need in our community, but it is good that you guys voice out what you think and feel about it, because we all need to share in that to reach our goals and also solutions. So I really appreciate all of you inputting on that. If there is no other thing, I just want to hope everybody had a good evening and stay healthy, and we can go outdoors. I was outdoors. It's a little difficult at times, but I think we'll be fine. And I'm hoping that everything will go back to normalcy soon, because I know we're all going crazy, but I think things will work out in the short term. I don't want to wait long term. So I agree with you, Commissioner Martinez, and also Commissioner Durson, all the other two commissioners too. So if there's no other comment, maybe I can have a motion to have adjourned tonight's meeting. Although I could stay and talk to you guys all night and share with you, that'll be fun. But I think we'll close the meeting. We can talk at some other time. But thank you, guys, everybody.
I'd like to close this meeting.
Okay.
My second motion, but also I want to congratulate Albert and Mr. Dursa there for their new positions. So
Albert and Mr.
Look forward
Dursa.
To it. I hope I hear long enough.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Care, everybody. Stay healthy.